Low back pain is a common complaint worldwide. According to earlier reports, the etiology of low back pain is nonspecific in many cases. The causes of low back pain have not been clearly established, but it may be other than the lumbar spine. We have been treating low back pain involving the lumbar spine using treatments such as surgery. We also focused on non-specific low back pain elicited by factors other than the lumbar spine, and we're conducting related clinical research studies. In this video, we will focus on cluneal nerve entrapment and present our findings. Many reports indicate that the lumbar spine is only one of the contributors to low back pain. The lumbar spine was involved in about 25% of our patients with back pain. Paralumbar spine diseases such as superior and middle cluneal nerve entrapment, gluteus medius muscle pain, and sacroiliac joint pain also elicit nonspecific low back pain. Not much attention has been paid to these causes in spite of their relatively high frequency. We've conducted clinical studies examining the pathophysiology and the outcomes of surgical and non-surgical treatments of such diseases. We compared the preoperative quality of life of patients with carpal tunnel syndrome, lower extremity entrapment neuropathy, and paralumbar spine diseases with their postoperative quality of life. Their pre- and postoperative overall health status was assessed on the Medical Outcomes Study Short Form 36 Health Survey Version 2. The pre-treatment scores are shown on this graph. A score of 0 is the worst possible health status, and a score of 100 is the best possible health status. In all patients, the pre-treatment scores for bodily pain and the scores on the physical component summary were significantly lower than the national standard. Also, the score for physical functioning was lower than the national average in patients with lower extremity entrapment neuropathy and paralumbar spine diseases. This is marked by the hashtag on the graph. Except for the mental component summary, the preoperative scores were significantly lower in patients with paralumbar spine disease than in the other patients. Postoperatively, the scores for physical functioning, body pain, and the physical component summary were significantly improved in patients with paralumbar spine disease. Our findings indicate that the diagnosis and treatment of paralumbar spine disease are very important issues in patients with low back pain. The cluneal nerves are cutaneous and pure sensory nerves. They dominate in the sensory perception in the lumbar area and buttocks. The superior cluneal nerve originates at the lower thoracic and lumbar posterior nerve root. It penetrates the thoracolumbar fascia around the iliac crest. Entrapment at that site is what elicits low back pain. The middle cluneal nerve originates at S1 to S4. It passes below the long posterior sacroiliac ligament, between the posterior superior iliac spine and the posterior inferior iliac spine, and then goes over the iliac crest to the buttocks. Entrapment there can also cause low back pain. In our experience, low back pain due to cluneal nerve entrapment is exacerbated by lumbar movement, such as extension, bending, rotating, prolonged standing, sitting, walking, and rolling. Cluneal nerve entrapment also produces leg symptoms in some patients and mimics radiculopathy due to lumbar disorder. It also elicits intermittent claudication, resulting in back pain when you walk. Since these symptoms are similar to the symptoms of lumbar disease, doctors need to make a differential diagnosis. However, the cluneal nerves are very thin, so CT and MRI scans are not diagnostically informative. In patients with cluneal nerve entrapment, a tunnel-like sign is detected at the site of nerve penetration. Patients experience numbness and radiating pain in the affected area upon trigger point compression. This is an important diagnostic symptom. Another important diagnostic clue is that the pain disappears when the nerve is blocked. We investigated the pathological features of 7 nerves in 6 patients whose low back pain was relieved by superior cluneal nerve neurectomy. The nerves showed several pathological changes, such as marked enlargement, decreased myelinated fiber density, an increase in thinly myelinated fibers, perineurial thickening, subperineurial edema, and Raynaud bodies. Morphometric analysis showed that the myelinated fiber density of two nerves was reduced. Both large and small myelinated fibers were involved. Our findings suggest that superior cluneal nerve entrapment neuropathy can elicit low back pain via nerve compression. Cluneal nerve entrapment has been diagnosed in the presence of other lumbar diseases such as lumbar spinal canal stenosis, lumbar disc herniation, scoliosis, and vertebral fractures. In such cases, low back pain may be controlled by less invasive cluneal nerve entrapment treatment without treating the radiological spine abnormalities. Patients with Parkinson's disease may experience low back pain due to cluneal nerve entrapment, but if it's treated, it may help to improve their posture and quality of life. Some patients may report persistent or recurrent symptoms after lumbar surgery. Others fail to respond to treatments. This is known as failed back surgery syndrome. Cluneal nerve entrapment elicits symptoms similar to those of lumbar spine disease. Its treatment in patients with failed back surgery syndrome may contribute to their improvement. We examined the surgical outcomes of 74 patients who underwent lumbar decompression surgery without any fusion procedures. The study covered a mean of 26.2 months after the first lumbar spine operation. Of the 74 patients, 54, that's 73%, reported improvement of symptoms after the initial lumbar spine surgery. The other 20 continued to experience symptom recurrence during follow-up. They required several treatments, including cluneal nerve entrapment surgery, and then their symptoms finally improved. Our findings also show that the treatment of cluneal nerve entrapment contributes to the treatment of low back pain after lumbar fusion surgery, and that failed back surgery syndrome may be associated with something other than lumbar disease, like cluneal nerve entrapment, and that its treatment may yield good results. Middle cluneal nerve entrapment mimics sacroiliac joint pain, which is also associated with low back pain. The sacroiliac joint score is diagnostically useful because it helps to differentiate between sacroiliac joint-related pain and pain due to lumbar disc herniation and lumbar spinal canal stenosis. Differential diagnosis between middle cluneal nerve entrapment and sacroiliac joint pain can be difficult because the site of the pain in patients is similar. We successfully treated 4 patients with a high sacroiliac joint score. Their pain was attributable to middle cluneal nerve entrapment. Among 18 patients with a positive sacroiliac joint score, 4, that is 22%, failed to respond to sacroiliac joint treatment. However, they did respond to middle cluneal nerve entrapment treatment. So, we suggest that in patients with suspected sacroiliac joint-related pain, when the effect of the sacroiliac joint pain treatment is unsatisfactory, middle cluneal nerve entrapment should be considered. Specific treatments for cluneal nerve entrapment are nerve blockage and surgical neurolysis. Under a surgical microscope, we performed less invasive surgical neurolysis of the superior cluneal nerve at the penetration site on the thoracolumbar fascia. After making a 4-centimeter skin incision under local anesthesia, we were able to identify the superior cluneal nerve by applying intraoperative nerve stimulation. Successful completion of the procedure was confirmed by intraoperative symptom abatement. To confirm sufficient nerve decompression, we used intraoperative indocyanine green video angiography to monitor flow improvement in the peripheral blood vessels. Postoperatively, the patients were able to walk freely without restrictions or external fixation. They were able to resume their daily activities on the first day after the operation. This slide shows the long-term surgical results we obtained in 52 patients treated by superior cluneal entrapment neurolysis. In about half of the patients, both sides were involved. Some patients presented with additional problems, such as lumbar spinal canal stenosis, lumbar disc herniation, and vertebral fracture. Of these 52 patients, 21, that is 40%, presented with low back pain only, and the remaining 31 patients suffered from leg symptoms. Their symptoms were aggravated by body posture and motion. The symptoms of all 52 patients were ameliorated by superior cluneal neurolysis. Their JOA scores, which is the Japanese Orthopedic Association scores, and their RDQ scores, which is the Roland Morris Disability Questionnaire scores, were significantly improved at the last follow-up. This slide shows our less invasive surgical neurolysis of the middle cluneal nerve under a surgical microscope. We made a 4-centimeter skin incision under local anesthesia, split the gluteus maximus muscle, opened the fascia, and explored the distal portion of the middle cluneal nerve. Since the middle cluneal nerve penetrates the long posterior sacroiliac ligament, it can be decompressed by cutting the ligament. This procedure releases the middle cluneal nerve up to its distal portion. These are the short-term surgical results we obtained in 11 patients who developed no surgical complications. Their symptoms improved after the operation. Their pain numeric rating scale, their RDQ score, and their JOA score were significantly improved after surgery. We decompressed one middle cluneal nerve branch in 9 patients, 2 branches in 1 patient, and 3 branches in 1 more patient. One patient required reoperation because we failed to explore the other middle cluneal nerves during the first procedure. Based on these findings, we suggest that surgeons should be on the lookout for an additional middle cluneal nerve that might need decompression because 11 to 18% of these nerves feature 2 or more branches. Among patients who underwent surgery for middle cluneal nerve entrapment, some required additional procedures to treat superior cluneal nerve entrapment. Our experience indicates that in some patients with lower back pain, both the middle and the superior cluneal nerves may be entrapped. We investigated 271 surgeries for cluneal nerve entrapment and recorded complications encountered within the first 30 postoperative days. The complication rate was 1.5% and involved 4 sites. Of these, 1 required reopening and suturing for local wound infection. Conservative treatment was successful in addressing 2 local infections and 1 subcutaneous hematoma. There were no major complications. Our results indicate that cluneal nerve neurolysis is less invasive and safe. High-frequency thermal coagulation is one option for treating middle cluneal nerve entrapment. We use this technique to address 3 sites between the posterior superior and the posterior inferior iliac spine. All patients reported pain amelioration. High-frequency thermal coagulation yielded longer and greater pain relief than the injection of 1% lidocaine. However, during our 24-week follow-up, 4 patients suffered pain recurrence and required additional treatment. I hope you found this overview of our work interesting. Thank you for watching. For more information, please see the cited papers and our textbook published by Springer-Verlag in 2021.